Zofloya, or The Moor, by Charlotte Dacre. Read by Lucy Scott for Naxos Audiobooks. Chapter 1. The historian, who would wish his lessons to sink deep into the heart, thereby essaying to render mankind virtuous and more happy, must not content himself with simply detailing a series of events. He must ascertain causes and follow progressively their effects. He must draw deductions from incidents as they arise and ever revert to the actuating principle. About the latter end of the 15th century, on the birth night of the young Victoria di Loredani, most of the youthful nobility of any rank in Venice were assembled at the palazzo of her parents to do honour to the festival. The hearts of all appeared in unison with the hilarity of the scene. Even the lovely and haughty Victoria smiled with an unchecked vivacity. For no fair Venetian had presumed to vie with her, either in beauty of person or splendour of decoration. Another circumstance contributed to elevate her spirits and render her triumph complete. Leonardo, her brother, ever haughty and turbulent in his manners, had acknowledged that she outshone every female present. At this time, the Marchese di Loredani had been married 17 years to Laurine di Conari, a female of unexampled beauty and of rare and singular endowments. If she possessed a foible, it arose from vanity, from too great a thirst of admiration and confidence in herself. At the period of her marriage with the Marchese, she was scarcely 15, and he himself not more than 20. It was a marriage contracted without the concurrence, without even the knowledge of respective friends, resolved on in the delirium of passion, concluded in the madness of youth. Yet unlike the too frequent result, disgust and repentance did not follow this impetuous union, for chance and circumstances happily combined to render it propitious. Time had not yet perfected the character of Laurina. She saw beside her an husband whose ardent love appeared to suffer no diminution. No temptations crossed her path. It required, then, no effort to be virtuous. And as, in revolving years, reason approved the choice of a passion at the time undiscriminating, she gradually adored as an husband him she had thoughtlessly selected as a lover. Two children, within 2 years after their marriage, had been its only fruits. From this circumstance, lavish and imprudent was the fondness bestowed by the parents upon their idolized offspring. Boundless and weak was the indulgence forever shown to them. The youthful parents little comprehended the extent of the mischief they were doing. To see their wayward children happy, their infantine and lovely faces undisfigured by tears or vexation, was a pleasure too great to be resigned from the distant reflection of future evil possible to accrue from the indulgence. The consequence was that Victoria, though at the age of 15 beautiful and accomplished as an angel, was proud, haughty, and self-sufficient, of a wild, ardent, and irrepressible spirit, indifferent to reproof, careless of censure, of an implacable, revengeful, and cruel nature, and bent upon gaining the ascendancy in whatever she engaged. The young Leonardo, who was a year older than his sister, having been as much the victim of an injurious fondness as herself, possessed, with all the bolder shades of her character, a warm, impassioned soul, yielding easily to the seductions of the wild and beautiful, accessible of temptation, and unable to resist in any shape the first impulses of his heart. This disposition, though it perhaps might never lead him into vice, would prevent him from repelling its inroads with the iron shield of energy. He was violent and revengeful, yet capable of sacrificing himself to a sentiment of gratitude. He had a quick, impatient sense of honour, feelings noble, though impetuous, and a pride, encouraged infinitely by the Marchese, of birth and family dignity, which, sooner than by an act of meanness have disgraced, he would have perished. Thus it could not be denied that in his ill-regulated character were some bright tints. Such were the children whom early education had tended equally to corrupt, and such were the children whom to preserve from future depravity required the most vigilant care, aided by such brilliant examples of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.